everybody, and welcome back to the Insomnia True Silver Championship. I'm your host, Nimsh, and I'm here with all the casters, the guys in the black shirts, the guys in the shirts which are not black. Basically, wow. Lothar, Noxious, Raven, and this is the grand final. The winner is getting $10,000. It's the loser. It's hard to call him the loser because he is getting $5,000 as well.
Right, and the second place, which, I mean, being in the final itself is a great accomplishment. And also, it's the first international Insomnia tournament, like the big broadcast tournament. So, it's I would say it's very important to be in the first grand final, because I'm sure the second one will be coming soon, and this might be one of the most viewed secrets in 2016, right?
Absolutely, it might be the end of the tournament, but this is the start of something great, because Insomnia events will happen. We will have one in Scotland, one in Ireland as well, and obviously in UK, global Insomnias in the future. So this will be the first big Insomnia champion.
Yeah, it's going to be huge. And also, like you said about the achievement of them being in the finals, when you look at the actual runs these players have had to make to get to the finals, it's pretty stacked tournament, probably one of the most recently anyway, so it's pretty huge.
Absolutely. And Legendarin actually had won championships on the UK ground before. He won Gfinity, and he qualified for the European Championships last year. So he is, maybe people don't know him that well. Some people even think he is from the UK. Noxious?
No, nothing. I said nothing. He is not local. I know that.
Where's he from?
He's from Sweden.
No,
the worst part is, I knew it, but it slipped.
You will always remember it now, because you will probably say his nickname, which is Legendarin.
Legendarin, yeah. The worst part is I know it, because he said, my name, I go by the name Legendarin. I'm from Sweden. I'm like, yeah, I know that. Thank you. And I said, he's a local. Totally, you know, UK players tends to win the grand final. No, it's not. It's not. There's no UK player. But he does play for London Conspiracy, which initially...
It's a UK-based organization.
That was my organization. Yeah. It's like, oh, London Conspiracy. Yeah, he has to be.
Yeah, so it's
so he is a Swedish player in disguise.
It's like, you know, football teams. I almost said soccer. Football teams.
Good recovery.
You almost have no players from the country they're actually playing for these days. It's they just import.
That's players. Actually true.
It's So basically, London Conspiracy is slowly turning into Manchester United.
Into global team, basically, right?
Yeah.
And then on the other hand, we have the second finalist, RDU from Team G2, and
represent.
His way here to the final was just amazing. Just losing in the very beginning. He was one of the invited players, but still, he was losing in the very beginning. Then he made it because of the three-way tie. He was offered another chance that he took it with his Druid deck. He got here, he faced Life Coach, an opponent he respects and fears. And by the skin of his teeth, Dark Peddler into Juggle into Soulfire, he was able to make it. And we've just seen him win versus Visual, a UK local who did extremely well himself.
Yeah, I mean, Visual's, as we said that earlier, he's got to be happy with his performance. He was super happy to just win the UK qualifier to actually get into the top 16 and then just progress from there. But said RDU again, we were discussing it after the series as well. He played extremely solid in that last set. He had a lot of tough calls to make and made them all right.
We couldn't tell that about the semi-final, about the quarter-final of RDU, because his plays were mostly a really close calls to having to calling them misplays.
Yeah.
But in the semi-final, he was spot on.
Top notch, yeah.
Top notch. Top tier Hearthstone player.
Yeah.
Like in the video.
That's good. Yeah, he just came here to win the tournament, right? That's what he said.
Yeah, exactly.
I came here. Why did you come here? My name is RDU, and I play for G2 Esports, and I came here to win the tournament. Well, thank you. That might just happen.
I'm the best.
Exactly. So there's a chance that he does it. So props to him for at least making it back when he was about to leave.
Absolutely.
Tiebreaker.
And both players, they have really interesting decks as well, because RDU is bringing, players brought Warlock, but there is Zoo and Maligos Lock. So a bit different setup there. There is Rogue from Legendarin, and Rogue was one of the MVP classes in the tournament so far. Druid from RDU, Druid from Legendarin, but again, a difference. Legendarin is playing the aggressive Druid, and RDU is playing a standard mid-range one.
Right. I feel like the Druid from Legendarin, you know, the aggression that it packs, usually you would say it lines up very well against other decks, but the thing is, RDU is running two decks that are pretty aggressive, and Zoo is able to push off the Paladin off the board. Assuming you're able to survive the early mini-bots I mean, the early aggression that is Lepronome that you see from the Druid, followed by Aspirants, let's say, or Sabers, you have taunts. The Druid eventually has to go through the Defend of Argus. The eggs get popped. Everything kind of becomes awkward. So I think the Zoo from RDU has a decent chance in that case.
Yeah, and then you look at the Rogue from Legendara. Normally has a great matchup versus most Paladins, but how is it actually going to perform versus the highly aggressive list that we've not really seen from anyone else so far? Normally, when you say Paladin, mid-range Secret, and maybe someone brought Murlocs, you know, we'll see. But
no.
Not normally one of the two, which Rogue can normally deal with relatively well. But versus the aggro list, if the Paladin runs over him too quickly, it's something that Rogue definitely struggles with.
Absolutely. We have six different decks, and the players are ready. Game one is starting right now. This is the final Insomnia True Silver Championship. Ladies and gentlemen, Paladin versus Malelok.
Yeah, how do you feel about that? Like, is that a matchup as an aggro pally that you're happy to run into? Like, Malygos Warlock is usually able to, you know, get some early game, but the thing is, the board clears they have may not be effective.
I mean, there's not that a lot of heal, right?
Right.
Also, you have the access to Brand Bronzebeard Healbot, which is 16, which is like a practically Arena Jackson in the deck,
yeah.
Right? But you need two cards. But you have more stable deck also. So it's a very different matchup from what we have seen the whole tournament, right? We didn't see that kind of matchup at all.
No, not at all. RDU's been kind of flying under the radar since he went to the tiebreaker very quickly. We didn't get to see much of his gameplay.
Yeah, and now the Lepronome starts the game with a kick.
Yeah. What's a hug?
Yeah, and look at RDU's hand overall. I mean, he's got Minibot, the Ardent Squire, Abusive for the trade-ups, and even coin into Shredder if he really feels like he needs to later. So He's definitely got the aggressive start he needs versus Malygos Lock to be able to just burst through maybe too quickly for that, say, Bran Healbot combo to come off.
Yeah, his hand looks pretty good, but then Legendarian has the Sir Finley Murgleton, and we've seen that from AK Wonder in the very beginning. He took it early, and Sir Finley can be useful. Maybe you can just take heal, because this is an aggressive Paladin. If you just continuously deal with the board, at some point Paladin will run out of damage. And if you start healing like a priest, you may just survive there.
Even Mage Ping would be okay.
Yeah, Mage
a lot of one health, and it's not like the Druid hero power where, or the Rogue one where you can chip for one damage, but you take the damage in return. Like, the ping can be really nice to just there. Cherry pick which minions you just want to finish off there.
By the way, Lepronome should have another saying when he's being played, which is, should I give you a hand? No, he's falling apart.
Oh, that would be very cool. When he dies.
Yeah.
When he dies, he should actually say that.
Turn 3 for RDU. Seems like
Do you like the muster coin abusive to trade into the M-Gang? Because then you can kill the 1-1 that comes out of it.
Oh, yeah, actually, yeah, that's very
You're forcing good Hellfire, and then you go for the Shredder.
Yeah, that's actually a very cool play. I like that a lot.
Yeah, and you even have the second abusive to the, if the Hellfire doesn't come, you can continue to trade up with against the bigger minions from the Malygos.
Yeah, which is the whole idea of the deck, basically, is you're trying to be aggressive, force the clears, go faces when you can, and then eventually you push with charge. You've got the two Blessings of Might, you have the
King,
you have like a lot of damage that can just come out of the hand.
Yep, and also with this board, he's always just testing, does Legendarian have Hellfire? Because if he does, surely he'd use it this turn. Mm-hmm. And we can see that it's not going to come down, so that gives RDU a big heads up there, and means he can either commit a bit more onto the board, or then try and carry on with things, any buffs that he gets as well.
Yeah, that's a good point. But now, Legendary is practically pushed to use the Imp Gang boss and the Sylphinia thing.
Yeah, just for the board presence, the one attack minion with 3 health is good enough, and it might give you a hero power that you're happier to use. I mean, you can follow it up with a Blackwing Corruptor on 5, kill something immediately, and from there maybe reevaluate. Because right now, tapping is not an option, and replacing that hero power is almost always going to be better.
Yeah, absolutely. He just needs to play the minions. And it seems like he goes for it. Sir Finley hits the board first. There is the mage hero power. Immediately picks it. He was looking for that one specifically.
Well, the rogue hero power wasn't bad either, right?
It's a lot of face damage when you're not guaranteed heals and the Blessing of Kings.
Wow.
That's from RDU. A
huge deal. Oh, wait, is it? Maybe you just go with the Palace Shredder this turn?
I don't dislike the Shredder, yeah.
You know that the opponent doesn't have the Hellfire, doesn't have the Shadow Flame.
Wait.
Probably, right?
Actually, wait, Abusive is better, right? You Abusive, you trade up, and then you Ardent Squire Hero Power.
Do you trade up? I don't like the trading up.
Really, that bad?
I think you could bless even Blessing of Kings, the mini-bot, and then just use the 2-1 and the 1-1 to go into Finley, and then just leave the 2-4 on the board.
Why would you kill Finley, though?
I mean, it's a one-attack minion.
Just because Finley's just going to chip away all your 1-1s anyway, so would you not rather it just clear it off the board for two minions? And then Hellfire's not as good anyway, because one, you've got a bigger minion, and you've got less tokens on board, so Hellfire now just doesn't really, really do too much.
It has to be Hellfire Coil, and now the Blackwing Corruptor does not kill anything, which RDU absolutely knows.
Oh, and you can't even play you can play the Guardian, but it's going to feel really bad when the minibot just straight up kills it, so...
On the other hand, you have the ping, right? So if you play the Twilight Guardian right now, next turn you might just ping and finish off the shield minibot, and then play Twilight Drake.
I like that. I would even consider playing Twilight Drake now, actually.
I would consider playing Corruptor now. You Corruptor, deal 3 damage to the minibot.
Force a trade.
So your opponent has to trade or lose to the ping the minibot next turn, right?
Yeah, it puts him in a really rough position because you don't want to trade with something that big. Yeah. But you can't leave the Corruptor alive either. You don't just want to leave your opponent with a 5-4.
I think RDU will be perfectly content with maybe using the Abusive with the weapon on the 1-1 to kill the 5-4, get the 6-1, force 2 mana from his opponent to be used up just to deal with the 6-1 again. But he's going for the Shredder. Develop all those sticky minions.
So he. I actually don't like you not using the Abusive Surgeon this turn.
Well, I mean, he can
always. It's a good opportunity to use it, right?
Yeah, and you're pushing the opponent to maybe not even play the ping, right? Because he might just use a Emperor in this situation,
and then get a really good follow up and force you to trade away a multiple minions into it.
Yeah,
I could see that. Oh man, that ping.
It was the first of many.
Oh wow.
Well, that's
that's insane.
Yeah, that's
a 5 damage and attack from the weapon to kill the Twilight Guardian, you still have a huge minion on board.
Yeah, you're just
abusive. Abusive one of the 1-1s to kill the Guardian as a 3-3.
Keeper of Ulduman, your abusive.
Your Argent Squire,
that's what I'm talking about. Your Keeper of Ulduman on your abusive. On your Argent Squire and the Abusive Surgeon, the Argent Squire, so it has 5 attack.
That's great.
That's actually better.
Yeah, that's better. Okay.
Yeah, instead of negating, because basically you'd be dealing 3 damage to it, right, if you put it that way. Now, doing this, he's keeping the shield. Oh wow! Keeping the shield on his Argent Squire, which makes it even better. It's a super mini-bot if he goes for that.
I think he actually would go for the Leroy Jenkins this turn. He knows there's no Hellfire.
And he can kill the 1-1s now.
So he can kill the 1-1s, still leave the Abusive... Argent Squire on board with the Divine Shield.
Yeah, that's right.
That's true.
He doesn't have to, though, because Leroy Jenkins is still concealed damage.
So, it's a fireball hidden.
It is, yeah.
Why use the Pilot Shredder with the Abusive Surgeon instead of going
to keep the shield?
I think this is, like, safe versus, like, the top deck Hellfire or anything like that. Because now the shield, the Argent Squire survives still as a 3-3.
Whereas Hellfire ping.
Yeah, and the 3-4, this either Hellfire ping, but then the 3-4 survives as a 3-1.
So this is 1 damage of lethal, or like close to it.
What do you mean?
He has to...
It's 7, 10, 13, 19 damage right now. So if you don't use the Soulfire, you're dead.
Yeah. So like he has to use the Soulfire, he can use the ping. So basically he can slam the Twilight
Drake. Yeah. That's
ping,
right.
And then he might be forced to Soulfire because it is a lot of damage.
Let's hope for him he doesn't discard Brandon top deck Healbot, because he'll probably have very, very salty tears. All right, the worst card's out.
There is still a chance for Brandon Healbot.
Another massive battle, which is cool, because that stacks damage from the hero power. From the hero attack.
Yep.
So that's fine for him. He has 6-7 damage, 8 damage this turn. You don't care about the Twilight Drake anymore. Because that's not the situation you just play around.
Yep, and as the turn's gone as well, the odds on him drawing that Blessing Might. He has 2 in the deck and we've not seen 1 yet.
Yep.
So Leroy's gonna come out of nowhere. Legendarion can draw into
the
Healbot.
He's playing around Shadow Flame in this situation.
Yeah, if Hellfire comes out, he doesn't mind, because that weakens the Warlock quite a bit. Dark Bomb, not exactly
never AoE
useful, yeah.
But that's just game, right?
So He pinged 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and that, in fact, is exactly game, I think, despite the ping on the 1-1. The Leroy deals exactly fireball levels of damage to Legendary, which means that the Paladin from RDU not only will take a game, but maybe gets to sweep or, you know, take two decks with it.
It is highly possible. Rogue should be weak to it, and then aggressive Druid might be weak to it as well, because you are bracing, like, both of you, and RDU has the Divine Shield and weapons. So that is a very important win, and yeah, with Leroy Jenkins, RDU is actually taking game number one versus Legendaren in the final.
It's the second time we see that RDU is finishing up the game with the Leroy Jenkins.
Yeah, and he's had it in hand for quite a while for both games, wasn't it?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Like, the fireball with legs.
Yeah, I remember how when it used to be four mana, it was literally that. The one other thing to keep in mind as well about the deck that RDU is playing is that you remember the old, and I mean old, Tempo Rogue, right? There was a time where you would play Squire on one, and then maybe get the Tinkmaster out, take a chance. If the Squire becomes a 5-5, you're golden. If it becomes a 1-1, then you've used up the shield already, so you don't care. And the Keeper of Uldamon kind of functions in a similar way with the Squire.
Yeah, that's true.
And I kind of like the fact that you're always transitioning the bigger and bigger minions from the early game that are useless become just greater with the Keeper.
Yeah. Yeah, this means that Keeper is a great card. Flexible.
Right.
And playable, absolutely. And it's another Forge for Paladin, so make your pick.
That's the only way they could make the card, like, more reasonable. They put it in the same slot as Shredder. Go.
RDU has a small problem, though. He saw that Legendaren kept three cards in his opening hand.
Yeah.
That means there's Backstep and Pen of Knives.
And possibly SI and everything else that you don't want to see. Yeah.
Maybe Agent. Mm-hmm. But most situations, what you would like to look for is the AoE. So Blade Flurries and Fan of Knives, because those are the MVP cards against this kind of Paladin.
Yeah, I mean, if RDU goes for the abusive here, yes, he's playing slightly off curve, but would you play it if it were two mana in this spot? That's a question you always have to ask yourself. If the answer is yes, then you play it.
If he plays Abusive Surgeon, then his Cockhammer is really bad on turn 3.
Right.
And I think he doesn't want to go for the Massive Battle on turn 3. Not against Rogue.
He's afraid. He expects the Fan of Knives now.
By the way, do we agree on the matchup? Because normally Rogue is really good versus Paladin, but this is aggressive Paladin with charge, with buffs. And Rogue might struggle against that aggression. It's like Face Hunter, kind of. But then it is weak to Master for Battle into Fan of Knives. And there are situations where Rogue can actually abuse.
I think Rogue might be a little bit more okay versus this than Face Hunter, because the Paladin doesn't have the consistent damage from the hero power that the Hunter can push, but it's still a tough one. Like, with Legendaren's draw, then he's probably going to be feeling pretty good, but in general, I do still think the Rogue's going to struggle with any hyper-aggressive deck.
There's the one card that is needed for RDU, which is Sir Finlay.
Yeah.
Me Hunter now.
Me go face? Yes.
Well, he can also get the daggers or even shapeshifts.
The daggers? You know what? The shapeshifts as my shaman always scared me. Good thing Paladins don't have anything as ridiculous.
Well, they do actually have Light Justice. And if you have shapeshift, you suddenly...
Oh, goodness. I did not think about that. Oh, no. That is nasty. Never again. Paladins, not even
That's
once.
A very good setup for the Blessing of Kings next turn.
Yeah, you saw a Fan of Knives. What could go wrong?
Exactly.
And even now, you have a low threat.
That could go wrong. How much do you play into it? Because if you think about it, maybe Legendaren just wants to set up, the Violet Teacher right now.
I think he'll actually go for it, because I don't think he has time. Oh, actually, you know what's the best? It's Farseer, Dagger, kill 1/1.
So you just coin out the dagger,
yeah,
kill one
I
of the
1/1s,
and then we can a Blessing of King minion, let's say, if it gets buffed. Yeah. It's kind of clunky.
Why is it the best, though?
Because you set up a minion that will be trading in the future, you force your opponent to play Abusive Surgeons, because the way how RDU plays is that he's actually trading a lot, right? So you can force him to overextend, because with Farseer and coin, kind of indicates he has no second AoE, and he can just bluff the Blade Flurry here, right?
Yeah, well, he's going for the dagger and keep, which means RDU is getting a telegraph from his opponent that he's holding the AoE.
It mostly is a telegraph.
And now I think RDU, knowing that, is just going to play Lothab and go to town.
Yeah.
What if it's a bluff?
Well, what else is he going to do anyway?
Yeah.
It's like, what if it's a bluff? Yeah, well, you're still dead, right?
Yeah, the loadup is just a great play this turn. Your opponent is pushed to play a minion instead. He's dead in the waters with the coin.
Might backstab for 5, kill the Lothar, but that's 5 to the face.
Yeah. Yeah. He's actually already pushed the rogue to 19 as well, and with Blessing of Kings in hand.
Yeah, that's
all. All he needs
coming.
To do is draw the signature Leroy, and he's looking at lethal pretty soon.
Even Arcane Golem, and he still has that Cockhammer, which is dealing damage. And even though Legendarin has a lot of great cards, he only has Farseer to heal.
Yeah, I suspect we're going to see some kind of Tinker, Sharp Sword, Flurry next turn, or Backstab, or Flurry SI, depending on how big the minions get. It depends how many of them get just massive.
So this is a very tricky turn. What do you think about Cockhammer?
Cockhammer's good. To the face. It's you really have to think good. Yeah, you're that. Setting up 6 to the face. You're setting up a fireball.
Mm-hmm, exactly, for 3 mana. And you get the Divine Shield, which is very important against the Blade Flurry, right? Because you can protect your Lothar from an attack with
right beforehand
with the weapon in case there's no backstab or agent, right?
I like actually Keeper of Ulderman on your 1/1, and then attacking into the Azure Drake with both dudes and playing Shield and Nebot. So you have and going with Lothar face.
Oh my God, he wants him to sap it! Oh my God!
What a brilliant play!
That is actually genius, because now there's no way Legendarin can deal with this without a sap. Almost no way. And if he does that, then I think RDU is just a happy guy.
Well, there is no sap at the moment, so how do you kill the 9/9? There are some spells.
That's actually brilliant. I have to say that.
That is just smart. It makes so much sense.
It's perfect.
So you have to go for backstab, a coin, SI, and then flurry. No, you can't flurry because you don't have prep. Yeah, GG.
I don't even know what you can do.
Finish the game now. Concede.
Is it just it? Like, he has 7 mana still.
I mean, you can Farseer and then die. You can...
That's a very good move, Fluxus.
I mean, there's very... Like, honestly, if he buffs the weapon with the oil, he goes up to 6 attack, right? So technically, he could backstab Flurry, but like I don't see at what point he's able... Because he can go Flurry with the oil, but then there's no SI, so he can't finish it off. There's like no way.
No way to kill this.
Yeah, I can't even think of one. Without Eviscerate in a spot like this, it's almost impossible. He might have to face tank, which I think... is just not reasonable.
If he face tanks, he takes 9, so he has...
I was expecting a backstab ASI on the 2/2, just because it removes damage from the board.
That's basically it.
And a true silver champion.
He didn't even need it. He had the Cockhammer.
Yeah, but he just wanted to use the card from the top of the deck to take his opponent.
RDU!
Everyone else is tilting. Everyone else is tilting.
Oh man, this is an awkward position for RDU because
he seems pretty comfortable.
Normally before he was losing 0-2.
Yeah, he had to go with the reverse sweep, right?
And yeah.
Now it's like, oh God, is it the other way around?
Am I actually
winning this?
What do
I do in this situation?
Yeah, RDU is probably worried. He's like, justice must be coming because this can't happen, right? But we see Legendarin going to go for the last deck he's got, which is the Aggro Druid. This is the type of deck that can definitely just snowball out of control no matter what.
Absolutely. But I think Paladin is still in a better position because you do have those shielded minibots, you have weapons. So
you have the Owl for the taunts as well.
Yeah, absolutely. So you have ways to put more power on board early game. And if you win early game,
you win the game.
You basically win.
Yeah.
So we'll see. It obviously depends on the opening. Right now, RDU has the 1-drop, has the 2-drop, has the 3-drop. He probably has to keep his hand fully. Even though Abusive is not the best 1-drop, it's a 1-drop that starts dealing damage early.
Yeah, I mean, you have to play the Abusive perhaps on the Creeper, though. If you're expecting something like an Aspirant, the Abusive on its own doesn't deal with it very well. It's just that it escalates the kill on the Aspirant, you know, 2 turns later. But it does prevent... like a 1-drop play from the opponent. Uh-oh, that spells trouble for
Druid
RDU. Druid things are happening right now.
Yeah, Innovate Coin, that is like a Team Rocket start.
But that Druid of the Claw, I mean, you coin out the Aspirant, play Druid of the Claw turn 2.
It's pretty good.
Pretty damn good.
There's nothing the Paladin can do, right, besides Blessing of Might here?
There's no way you can deal with a Darnassus Aspirant if you coin that out.
Has to be abusive, number two.
You can't have Blessing, right?
But that's such a massive investment. God,
no way you can play Blessing and trade with Darnassus Aspirant.
No! you can't deal with this.
It doesn't work like that.
You can silence. Great play, my friend.
Yeah, great play. Give him permanent mana crystal to end game faster. That way I can go home and sleep.
So this means we just play spiders here.
Yeah. I mean, RDU.
I want you to carry on.
You want me to
just carry on with that for the whole game.
No, I don't.
We want RDU's train of thought.
No, that was an RDU's accent.
Really?
No.
It was close.
No, RDU's accent is it's specific to Romania.
I'm not a vampire.
Oh no. Oh god. Well,
this makes sense because of shapeshift, right? If there will be just a shapeshift, you want to deal with this.
That's gonna hurt.
It's tough.
But that's why the owl's there, right? The owl is there for situations like these.
It's still 4/6.
To kill the 2/1, you know? And you get to curve with Lepronome, which is good.
Yeah, but it is still 4/6.
I know it is, Nimsh.
I want to kindly remind you that we are racing here, Doctor.
Oh, we're racing. Never mind that. Sorry.
Well, he has more minions. If there's no swipe, and there will be no swipe for the next turn, it's kind of looking okay-ish for RDU, because he will just be constantly pressuring his opponent. I assume that next turn will be Hero Power and Haunted Creeper, if there will be no Blessing of Kings.
Yeah.
That sounds reasonable. See here, I like the play that the Legendary made, because he doesn't commit a Raptor, it's unnecessary. Instead, you play a one drop, kill one of his minions, so he can't kill your 4/6.
You limit the power on board, and then you push with your minion. You basically want to force, like, they both want to force each other to trade into minions.
Yeah.
Whoever starts trading first will be in a worse position.
Yeah, this is super weak to swipe, though. I mean, if there's a swipe from Legendary in this turn, off the top, then
if
that's just
game over. If he has a swipe, he wins the game at any given
that's
point
true,
of the game.
True.
So what RDU is doing here is just like, well, I need to go all fit.
He still has to do something, right? Yeah, of course.
He has double massive of a battle, so why not go right now when he can just have more minions on board?
Pick up a Kings, pick up a Blessing of Might, pick up this.
Oh, wow.
That's something.
A great card.
It's a 5/6 almost.
So you play Keeper of Ulduman on your own minion. You have 3, 5, 6, 8, 9 damage this turn.
I don't think you can afford racing, can you?
I'm just counting it.
Yeah.
Can he?
So if there's Druid as Saber with Savage Roar, you get punished. You know there's no swipe, so that discounts a range of cards.
Does he have a choice not to raise, actually?
You may have to steal
the
4/6,
if he trades,
right?
Will he just fall behind too much?
I don't think so. Reducing 4 attack off the board while you're losing 3 and establishing 3 is probably worth the trade-off.
And he actually has cards in hand to replenish the board.
Yeah.
If he stops trading, he will have that card in hand.
Better get lucky, mate.
Not impressive. You want
a 3-2.
Yeah, it's way better than a 3-2 or 2-3.
Yeah, I mean, a 3-2 here would have been devastating because the Raptor.
Oh, the trade.
That's
so
in time.
I mean, the swipe will still be a win the game card anyway.
Yeah,
it will win the game, but. Not too early.
Yeah, well, the thing is here, is RDU not going to muster?
You have to.
You wouldn't not muster, right?
Yeah, you have
Because you didn't see the swipe beforehand.
I can't see a world in
and
which
you can't play around it anyway.
Everything was awesome. You lived in a no swipe land.
For a little while.
Yeah.
So if he doesn't play muster, then he's playing around swipe very heavily. But nope. He does play straight into...
He can't play on.
Yeah, he has no choice. No choice at all.
Is he going to concede after this fight?
I guess so.
I think, knowing RDU, I don't think there's any chance that he sticks around after he sees combatant stay up. He doesn't have the answer. What's he going to top deck? True Silver, take another 5, then die. I don't think he's going to want to cope with that.
Yeah.
Get out of the game before the tilt. And, you know, trying to see everything.
He's not tilting, though.
He's not the player.
Everyone else is tilting.
Everyone else tilting because they don't concede fast enough.
especially because he is actually winning. He just eliminated 2 decks with a Paladin. So it's fine. RDU concedes, and Legendarian gets the first game of the match with that Aggro Druid.
Is Zoo favorite?
I say yes.
Aggro Druid?
Yeah,
Because you have Voidwalkers, which are a great way to stop Lepronomes, great way to stop Living Roots. right? I got a good answer against Dennis Aspen. If you have the abuse charge,
yeah.
On paper, it's actually a weird matchup because in the very beginning you trade a lot, and it seems like Zoo wins the trade at some point, but then you have the combo.
But then Fel Reaver hits, and you're like, oh.
Well, I need POs for that.
Yeah, I need to use all my power of whelmings or mill his deck in some cases.
But, milling
never
the deck
happens.
Is most likely not very effective.
Unless Dark Peddler, Golchar Footman, your call, Fel Reaver.
Well, that's the Peddler.
Like the best way to win this is Sacred Druid is, again, pressure. And make Zoo trade into your minions where you pressure deal enough damage to finish with the combo. And Zoo will actually deal damage to itself as well.
Oh, well, that looks like a good opening.
Sick opening here for RDU.
What do you think about Knife Juggler 2-in-1?
Yeah, it looks to me like the best opener you could possibly hope for. And you can protect it for a while against a deck like this.
Innervate will be dreadful. Nope.
Well, that needs to be done to Aspen now. And now, I think what RDU will do is just playing, he will play Peddler or the Egg and trade for the Nasus Aspirant. Ooh. Because he is, I'm sure, 100% sure, he will play around Keeper of the Grove. 100%.
You have to make the trade. There's no way you can let that Keeper come out of the turn early.
I wonder how the Raptor will perform. We haven't seen that much Raptor.
Get popped and spawn a 4-4. That's what it'll do.
A 4-4?
From the Raptor?
Well, from the egg killing itself.
Oh, that makes
you
sense.
You guys are going to be the death of me.
Wait, what are the stats of the Kvaldir?
2-4.
The Kvaldir, it's a 2-4.
Okay.
Yeah, it does kill this minion with a Keeper.
On the deck!
No way!
What?
Whoa, this is insane. Look at that.
It's actually pretty good.
Yeah, it's going to go up to 2-3. What? What?
What was that?
Please, nerf.
I don't even know anymore.
Ooh, and the Fel Reaver. RDU is lacking the PO, but he has the Peddler, and the Peddler is always giving what he wants.
Yes, we know that.
Yeah,
we've seen
almost
that.
Always. But
well, he did get the PO in the first one. Well, just couldn't play it.
Yeah, you're right. And Peddler did carry him here.
Yeah, I think it's like 25% chance to see PO. About like it adds up to that because it's about what 30-ish cards, and you have 4 times the chances.
Noxious Mouth.
So it's about from what I calculated, it's about like 25%. 1 time out of 4, you see like Soulfire and PO.
Do you even play the Death Rattles here? Because they're not looking that great, right?
Yeah, you can't kill
presence,
the...
But the +2 attack doesn't necessarily give you anything because you don't have swipe. You can bluff swipe with that if you attack with the Undertaker to the 4-1.
Oh my god.
It's like, oh, you have this swiper next to him. What do you do, bro?
That still might be the best play.
I don't dislike the play just because you're following it up with removal, but you might go face and bluff that swipe. Again, same idea.
Yeah. Well, you still go face because you want to pressure anyway. You want to make Zoo trade into your minions. That's basically what you want to do.
Oh, you would just ignore the Raptor. That's my guess.
I like that. It's good because it doesn't matter. If you go for Voidwalker, Direwolf, Flame Imp especially.
Oh, it's a Kvaldir.
Well, actually, there's a 4-4 waiting for that.
Yeah.
So it's not that horrible. But you have the Direwolf Alpha to also kill the Undertaker.
And it's a great card,
this
though.
It's actually perfect, though, because the Voidwalker really puts a stop to... everything, like if you
and you don't need to buff the Undertaker. Sorry, the Voidwalker with the Direwolf Alpha. I don't need a need for that, and I would actually want to see the Spectral Spiders being buffed next in for better trades.
No, but if the Voidwalker dries, you get the rest, right? Because I mean, he has to kill the Voidwalker. Oh my goodness!
All right, so
it's not quite a good.
It's still good
swipe yet,
it's
but
still
it's
good.
Not like the most amazing one because you don't get initiative afterwards.
The thing is, like. Without the swipe, it didn't look that great.
Yeah, I mean, I guess if you swipe the 4-2 and you just kill the Voidwalker, you're taking, however, 6 damage afterwards, which brings you down to 24, but you haven't taken any damage yet.
Yeah, and you still have Keeper on turn 6 and the Hero Power.
Or the Juggler.
Or just Fel Reaver.
Options.
All right, that Defend of Argus looks pretty tasty. No, it's not there.
Another Flame Imp.
That's
not horrible.
It is bad because you are getting lower and lower with Lifetap, you damage yourself, and this Druid has Force of Nature.
Well, look at that though.
Peddler
could make. Oh, wow, another PO.
So there's Power of Whelming, Young Priestess, and Undertaker. Those are the choices.
Take your time, man. Bluff it. Pretend like it's not good.
I think it's the PO, right?
You have to. You gotta shove all in. If you pick up anything that can deal damage next turn, you're just putting all your eggs in one basket.
And POS is one of the best cards versus Druid. Even you can use it to push, or you can use it to deal with something like Druid of the Claw with six toughness.
True. Fel Reaver, Druid of the Claw, name
absolutely,
it.
Yeah.
You have that option now.
I really like holding off on picking, because whether he's already decided or not, it does bluff to your opponent that, like, oh, okay, maybe I've got a hard choice here instead of just snap picking one.
Yeah.
And okay, well, that's definitely a good card if you just picked it.
He takes the Young Priestess to prevent himself from getting blown out of the game from another swipe, perhaps, my guess.
I wonder what it
would buff. What will it buff?
Well, he's seen one swipe, and he wants some more board presence.
That's not what he wanted to see, though. That's the worst buff, I think.
And we have to remember that this is actually the aggressive Druid. It's not the normal Druid.
Right.
So there are not that many taunts, no Ancients of Lore. If RDU is aggressive enough, he might actually outrun the Druid. But then Keeper is great.
Yeah, I like Keeper here on the dog. And he can probably snipe one of the others.
Snipe it!
No, no, that's actually a great... And defend of Argus right now for RDU. All right, now things are looking a little less grim. Very, very good, actually, because you Flame Imp, you buff the Peddler and the Flame Imp with the Defender, then you trade away, the Flame Imp in the middle and the Peddler, and you trade away into the 2-4, kill the 3-2, and keep going.
Well, it still just end up with what, like, with 3-3 and 2-3?
Yeah, but taunts. Fel Reaver doesn't matter. Force of Nature is going to be wasted. My question is, do you keep the Priestess?
I think you keep it.
Yeah. Yeah. So you trade
you
the Peddler
it's
away.
It's such a great minion to buff up the taunted up minions, right?
Yeah. That's exactly the thought, yeah.
Well, Priestess does something, right? And Peddler, as a choo-choo, doesn't do anything anymore.
That's right. I mean, so you buff up the Flame Imp and trade? Or do you buff
both
up? Yeah, that you buff the both Flame Imps and just push.
Go face.
Yeah. That's such a tough turn, though.
He might even think about using the PO to trade for the Keeper of the Grail, to be honest.
And keep his Flame Imps?
I don't think that
makes sense. You just buff everything that stays on the board.
I don't think it's correct, but a tough call.
This is kind of what we expected, and now due to the Claw, not going to do too much work. This hand right now from Legendarin is exactly the type of stuff you don't want to be stuck with.
Yeah, and that's one of the cards that can get dealt with the PO on the Young Priestess. Can he even afford not... You just slump for the Reaver. That's the biggest minion.
Yeah, you gotta hope that it works. And it, in this case, what it does is, worst case scenario, it opens up the board for you to push with more damage later on.
Yeah, because also, if the Fel Reaver can get rid of that Flaming, even Druid of the Claw charge to just remove a minion and then get rid
of...
Argent Squire PO really opens up the board. My question is, do you trade away your two small minions with the PO to keep the Flame Imp taunted up? Because I feel like that taunt is worth a lot more.
Yeah, the taunt will be very valuable. I think like you have to just sacrifice the Priestess and the Defend of Argus here.
It's a tricky situation because if you spend damage killing the Fel Reaver, you will kill the Druid slower, and most of the cards the Druid will draw actually deal damage. Combo,
sure, but the Imp doesn't. The Imp doesn't die.
Yeah, the Imp doesn't die yet. But then, like, Savage Roar, for example, with the hero power, is free damage.
Second Keeper of the Grove.
He does get to see what comes out, though. He doesn't see anything that he wants to delete from the deck just yet. No Force of Nature, no Savage Roar.
Oh, actually, that's a very big
Saber is gone, yeah.
Saber.
Only one left.
The mana is awkward. You can't really... Unless you play Paladin Shredder and Saber...
You have to taunt up the Druid,
that's
right?
Probably what you do. No, you don't. You can play Pilot, Shredder, and the Saber, actually.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, I think you have enough health to be able to play around with that and then go into taunt next turn.
Druid of the Claw might not ever see the taunt, because if you go for stealth, the Saber actually counters the 4-3, and then Druid of the Claw might charge with something like Savage Roar.
Makes sense. I mean, you're playing around the Doom Guard as well.
Even like if you don't get the Savage Roar, next turn, RDU plays nothing big, just charge face, and that's a 4-4. That has to die.
I think what Legendarian should do is, in this situation, just play the Palace Shredder and the Saber, but charge it and kill the Flame Imp instantly. Because what if?
With the hero power, I see. Yeah,
yeah, with the hero power.
It's just guaranteed.
Guaranteed trade. Yeah.
Well, this is exactly what RDU wanted. He gets to kill the 4-6 with the Dire Wolf and the Doomguard, not discarding anything, not even having to tap.
Yeah, and he can go face with the Doomguard with buffed attack as well.
The Doomguard. Probably just the Squire in the end.
Oh, it's right? You're right. It's much better, yeah. You want to talk.
Oh, man.
Now, this is looking tough for Legendarin. He has no way of killing that minion.
This is 10 damage, so it's almost over. RDU just needs 3 points of damage here.
Yeah, and I mean, the thing is, right now, if Force of Nature is top decked by Legendary, he wins next turn, but we'll see what RDU picks up. That's a lifesaver.
My god, that's almost lethal.
That's almost lethal. That was 1 damage, actually. That's 1. You can't play it between the wolf and the minions.
So, tap just, first, right? I
mean, the problem is...
Might as well.
Savage Roar might be lethal.
You can't.
That's game, right?
Yeah, oh, yeah, that's game.
That's game.
Yep.
Yeah, because you add plus 3 damage, right?
Yeah, he just needed 2.
Yep, wow.
Perfect.
There we go.
RDU is your champion. He's taking this game and winning versus Legendarin here. He's throwing all the decks on the back of his aggressive paladin, Enzu.
Nicely done, RDU. You saw that smile at the end there. I came to win, and I won.
And again, for RDU, he's won the whole tournament, and he brought aggro paladin, a deck that no one even... probably would have even guessed that would have been brought to the tournament with the power of Secret Paladin that we've seen in the meta for the past few months. Yeah. Even and then the resurgence of mid-range Paladin, say, and then RDU's like, yeah, I'm just gonna play aggro Paladin, and it works.
Super
like,
JJ
crazy.
Was laughing at him earlier. He was saying that deck is way too janky. Why are you playing that? RDU's like, no, I think it's good.
Well, to be honest, there's a lot of decks that actually draw cards. And, yeah. I was talking to Slytha before, and he was surprised that there are so many rogues. He was expecting a lot of aggressive decks. This deck is really good versus rogues. Rogues do love to draw cards, and you can be aggressive versus them as well.
Yeah, they use preps very early, so there's no redraw very often, so they end up like scrambling for answers. And that's kind of the what you want to do against rogues. Like in between turn 1 and 3, if you can just push, and they end up not having the flurry, then you end up winning the game on the back of that.
Absolutely.
Yeah, exactly. And I think we have RDU here.
Oh, yeah.
Better be.
Perfect. So RDU will join us in just a moment. We might not have... the mic for him?
There he is.
All right. Actually, RDU, let's go into the middle.
Oh, yeah, right.
All
right.
So, RDU, this is your mic.
This is your manager.
All right, RDU, first, congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations, man. How do you feel now?
I feel really good because I never expected it. Like, in the first day, as most of you might know, I started 0-2. So, at 0-2, I was like, okay, now I just want to go home, forget about the tournament, stop practice more because I played really badly in the first day. And then in the tiebreaker, then I managed to win one more. I mean, I just played for like whatever. I managed to win it, the last one. And then somehow the results happened in such a way that I got to tiebreakers. In tiebreakers, I really focused because I was given a chance that I didn't feel like I deserve. And I played my best. I won the tiebreakers. And then...
the game versus life coach, man. Tell me about it.
I made a lot of misplays, I think, but he also made a lot of misplays. It was like a very tension series, and it's very hard to play on stage. So I think it was like the hardest series for me of the tournament. Afterwards, I just gained composure because beating a player of the caliber of Life Coach, I think that I can beat anyone afterwards. So. I just YOLO'd and won.
Oh, that's exactly
it. And everyone
it.
Is tilting, right?
Yeah.
Well, you came here to win, man. Congratulations, you did.
Thank you very much. Can I give some shout-outs, please?
Of course.
Yeah,
sure, go ahead.
So, big shout-out to my practice partners, Crane and Super JJ, and big shout-out to my team for being super awesome.
Yeah, well done. Aww. Well done.
All right, I think it's a good moment to actually give you the trophy. So
okay.
We have the trophy here for you. This is yours, man. I don't know how we were going to transport it with the airplane, but this is your trophy. You're the Insomnia True Silver champion.
Oh.
The trophy is heavy, by the way.
It is super heavy. Congratulations again, RDU. Congratulations.
This table may or may not hold.
Yeah. So that was excellently played. Guys.
Congratulations, man.
Do you have anything to say about that series?
Hand of applause. Yes, no, maybe. Let's do it.
There you go.
Oh, that was kind of a small hand of applause.
This trophy is very, very...
heavy.
Good.
It's like 10 kilograms, I think.
It's a big responsibility. It's really heavy because, you know, you're the first global Insomnia champion, even though this is the 56th Insomnia event.
Feels good, man.
Seems good.
Seems good.
It does feel good, too, I imagine.
Guys, it was an amazing, amazing, amazing event. It started online with the qualifiers. We had a global qualifier, UK qualifier. Then we had here the LAN qualifier and 2 amazing days, amazing games. Just before we sign off, what are your favorite moments, Noxious?
I'm going to have to go with the Hunter versus Zoo with RDU, where the Hunter did not lower the health of the minions to one to play around the defend of Argus, which suddenly, I think in that process, Visual learned a very important lesson, because he was telling us how it, you know, he thought he wouldn't make it through, he felt like he didn't have the experience. That must have been an experience in the first place. Like you, from now on, he's always going to play around that. I like that.
The thing is that like the pressure is very high on the stage.
Yeah.
And it's super easy to forget some small things, and then the small things are gonna come back and bite you. So it's tough to play Hearthstone.
I never thought I'd hear those words.
That's a good information.
Yeah.
Raven, favorite moment?
Less of an in-game moment and more just seeing what the top eight looked like was really good. So it was a spread from the invited players, players who turned up, some UK players as well. So overall, just a really good top eight for the first enlarged Insomnia Hearthstone tournament.
All right, Lothar?
I think the Dark Peddler into Soulfire, into 33% knife juggler, but that was the second knife juggler for the 33% of the first one.
Yeah.
But that was my favorite moment.
Granted.
That was a pretty good moment. And for me, before I give you the mic, for me, my favorite moment was JJ versus Legendaren, Rogue versus Druid. They just couldn't kill each other.
That was insane.
That game was
That
so
was
good.
Insane.
Are your favorite moments besides winning?
The killing blow.
Throwing the Soulfire from the Peddler after I failed with the first Peddler, and then hitting the knife jacket, I was like, yes. One more thing, if I can mention it. I want to also give a shout out to Herudra for the Zulist. Like, I just saw him streaming and I thought it's a cool deck, so I just changed two cards and I got it. And big thanks to Taij for fixing my Druid list, because my Druid list was awful and he told me how to fix it. So big thanks to Taij.
All right, that's good. And we finish on a good notion, so I just want to thank everybody here. Thank you, Noxious, Raven, Lothar, for casting with me. And thanks to the production team, thanks to Multiplayer for making this event happen. That was an amazing event. Obviously, big thanks to the viewers and just watching us right now. So from me, from the crew here, from Insomnia, with all those people, thank you so much for watching. See you guys next time, and good night.